My name is Giulio Corradi. I'm the senior system architect for Xilinx for the industrial, scientific, and medical market. And my primary goal today is to introduce you a new technology that is called Zinc 7000. Zinc 7000 is a system that join together an FPGA, so a field programmable gate array, that is basically a hardware that could be programmed by software, so you can decide to run your software into a piece of hardware instead of a microcontroller or microprocessor. But Zinc 7000 is combining the two domains. One is the processing systems, and the other one is the field programmable gate array. In general, I would say I would use this type of example that is an electric drive. The electric drive is one of the very difficult and complicated system because it's a multi-time, multi-domain device that requires a significant amount of different time stamping to run the product. And we do see a significant amount of demand in hardware in the loop, particularly connecting the products that are connected in a simulation environment as well as connected to the machines that is executing then the output of the simulated environment. So I will present basically the realization of Zinc 7000 as a system on chip with Scilab, with the Scilab library, some Scilab example, a multi-level inverter, so going further, systems that are basically designed for high-power products, so electric drives, will implement what are called multi-level inverters, that are systems are capable to deliver high power with several steps instead of two steps, like an electric drive. And I will show you some additional elements related to a platform that is used today for industry and university, and in particular using Scilab as a front end to create a simulation as well as connecting and data acquisition. Let me explain a little bit why Scilab. Scilab is an open source platform, and many of our customers are starting to use this platform because it's very convenient. Many of our customers do not possess the ability to buy other type of tools that are normally considered a little bit more expensive. So it's accessible, expandable, and in the last years reached a professional level that many of our customers are now starting to appreciate. What is an FPGA today? Today an FPGA, as I said, is a combination of a programmable logic plus a significant amount of processing systems. We are delivering product at 28 nanometers, that is a very, very small scale, and it has the ability to run and accelerate the software into an embedded platform. So it's not a computer that sits in your bench, but it's a very powerful computer that you can fit inside an equipment, a device. So we are basically having a significant demand on what is called the Internet of Things, because this machine is a sort of supercomputer that is, could be connected nearby your product, and capable to process tons of data in reduced time. Today we are going in creating a combination of the ARM processing systems, so multi-core in our device, connected with the field programmable gate array, a sort of, let's say, seamless interconnection. You can program that system from a software standpoint, distribute your software partially in hardware, partially into the processor, partially in different processors that are in the system, and combining them all in order to create and extract from your software the maximum amount of performances. In general, I would say I'm not spending that much time on this material because you can find that on our website, but it's a combination of real-time control, so there is a specific processor for real-time control, a specific processor for application control. For example, in our Zinc device, we do implement an ARM core that is a 32-bit ARM core, is a Cortex-A9. There are two Cortex-A9, and looking forward in our product, in the next generation, will be a multi-core with four ARM processors, a significant amount of FPGA, and a real-time processor inside. How that is applied? Is applied, as I said, in an electric drive. One of my presenters, the predecessor, it was basically from the company in Neosys or something like that, presented the robotic arm. This is what you can find inside a single link, a single joint of a robotic arm. So there is a power modulation stage, a torque control, a speed control, a positioning control. It's a very sophisticated type of algorithm that should run in real time. Typically, for high-performance robots today, the power modulation and the torque control should be executed in a fraction of microseconds. This means that it's a continuous loop. For example, the PID control that you can find inside the torque control should run in less than a microsecond, as well as the speed control. So this poses a significant challenge to the developers. In particular, those developers has to do with the power conversion, motor driving, speed sensoring, power sources. Them all have different, as I said before, time stamping. So you can have a resolution of a millisecond for the power source, but 20 nanoseconds for the feedback controller. So when you try to simulate those systems, you should take into account a multi-rate product. So it's not really convenient, going further, to use just a simulation, but it's much more convenient creating, beyond the simulation, a mechanism that is getting real data out of the real product and feeding back that into the simulation environment. In this case, I'm basically showing you the two approaches. One is the traditional one. You model the system, you create a simulated model of the inverter, you converge with the model. When the model converges, you go to the final system, to your final hardware, you test that, you discover that it doesn't work, and you come back in the simulation environment. With this type of technology, with the FPGA, you have one of the advantages, important advantages, that is running much, much faster than a processing system. So you can basically connect your product, if it is implemented with this technology, in a loop within your simulation environment. What we basically did is connecting Scilab via a high-performance channel, that is a 1 gigabit Ethernet connection, to these systems, implementing a sort of intelligent agent on the FPGA side and a DLL on the PC side, and being able to have this kind of system completely integrated into Scilab. It's already, I would say, 3 years that we are presenting regularly this type of approach, and we do have already significant acceptance from customers. The most important point is that you get real data and you can tune your system in real time. I do have a little movie later on, if I will have a time to show you that. You are basically, the application is driving and suppressing the noise into a robotic arm. So when the robot's arm moves, especially for medical applications, the robot should move very smoothly, and it's very difficult to tune those parameters just with the simulation and the model. So the system is connected with Scilab and is basically able to optimize by means of the high-level software to optimize the movement of this arm. This is what is inside the Zynq 7000. So there are a couple of very high bandwidth connectivity with the processing programmable logic, so you can deploy basically your algorithm into a piece of hardware, combine this hardware, and getting access from your processing side. The realized application is this one. So there is a PC connection with a 1 gigabit communication to one processor. Most of the algorithms that control the drives are sophisticated beyond the basically translated from the software application into hardware, so those elements are executed in real time as a piece of hardware and connected. This is the case of two joints, so two links of the robotic arm, are connected to one of the Cortex-A9, and this Cortex-A9 is implementing basically an agent that transmit and receive data and execute those data directly into the hardware from the Scilab environment. Additionally, this environment could get many other data from communication networks and funneling all those data into the Scilab environment. So it's basically possible to combine different sources and getting access to the final product. So it's not a sort of laboratory product, it's a final target. So this means that this device could be deployed in the field, so the customer or the manufacturer could use that deploying in the field. So that's how it works. So the system connected via 1 gigabit communication using Scilab. We do have, for example, 2 instances, one using National Instruments, LabVIEW, and the other one using Scilab, that are using the same channel. So the operator is using, for example, the graphical interface from National Instruments and the optimization on Scilab, getting the same data in real time on the same time with the same type of performances. So the device that is basically the bottleneck of this this application is not the target, it's not the tiny embedded system, it's the PC. Because the PC has to execute Scilab, has to execute LabVIEW, so it's basically processing a significant amount of elements. So the other alternative that we had was basically running part of the Scilab, or Scilab also in our platform, because today the embedded platform that are delivered by Xilinx allows the system to run at more than 1 gigahertz, so it's an embedded platform, extremely powerful and extremely capable. This is what is running instead on the PC. So this part is the hardware, this is what is in the PC. In the PC there is the DLL, there are XML database, it's a little bit complicated. But basically, it's a sort of plugin that is entering into Scilab. There are also other products that could be used, and filing all the information through Ethernet. The final combination is this one. This is the embedded board. This is the actuator, power actuator. Inside the system, there is an agent that is getting all the information from the environment. This agent is using the UDP protocol. The UDP protocol is transforming into a remote procedure call, so a sort of interpreter, virtualizing the complete hardware. So you see from the Scilab environment the complete virtualization of this hardware. That allows you to connect part of your system, or your entire system in the loop, and getting all the benefits of the Scilab environment transferred into the embedded board. Basically, this is a Scilab script that we have discovered. So that you can see it's basically setting the speed of the model, connecting the link to the internet connection, activating the model, starting to make the vibration suppression, so on and so forth, and it's connected in real time to the board. There are some additional data that I'm letting in the presentation, so all the information funneled in the programmable logic. It is possible to implement very complicated systems. So in this case, we do have, for example, some libraries for the sensorless field-oriented control that are implementing via Scilab part of the model control, and in the board the nonlinear estimator transferred into the hardware device. For what concerns the additional parts, you can move even in the very complicated systems like a 3-level inverter. That is basically capable to deliver extremely high power to motors. It could be used for example, electrical car or aircraft, in where you have a very, very, we say, constrained environment in terms of weight. I'm skipping this slide because it's very technical. This type of configuration is using another board, which would have very high power system. In this case, Scilab is used in combination with high-speed industrial networking. So in order to get from a very high-power system, raw data like current acquisition, voltage acquisition, DC input is also the voltage acquisition, feedbacks, and if I can find it here, 1 gigabit Ethernet to the PC. So at the same time, you get connectivity from a field bus, so from for example, if the system is placed into the manufacturing unit, from the field bus that is delivering the data that controls a large machine, and at the same time you get from 1 gigabit communication Ethernet the data on Scilab. Scilab algorithms, you can implement some algorithms for optimization or fine-tuning or even data collection, and then transferring that in the system. So the combination of a very powerful simulation environment translated into the manufacturing, into the field, makes those type of solution very attractive, not just for the developer, but also for maintenance. People that are going there after, let's say, 6 months, the machine doesn't work as expected. For example, a ball bearing, or they have a failure in some part. It's very difficult to maintain creating a sort of diagnostic on such a system. Instead, plugging in Scilab, getting back the data and analyzing them in real time makes the system extremely advantageous. To give you a perception of how the world is realized, so you see, those are my power components. This is the little things with the device inside. This is a high speed 1 gigabit communication board, which is the channel that connects to this device. Those are 100 megabit communication channels that connect to this device. So all the data could be funneled in
parallel without any performance loss. That allows also having Scilab running as a background task on this system.
We developed a library of more than 200 functions for synchronization, model control, data control, current acquisition, fully integrated in this environment, so that the user is free to connect all those functions and getting basically a sort of remote control of the final board. In a final environment, in the industrial environment, as I said, the industrial PC is connected to the feed bus, the motor that is connected to the robotic systems is connected to the feed bus, and from the gigabit communication with the it's pretty significant the amount of performance that you get. In interest of time, I would skip this one. There is significant material if you want to look in internet and seeing one of the presentations, what type of performances are possible and available from these systems. And I'm hoping that there will be more Scilab user that could work in such a domain. If you want to get additional information, I'm putting in the presentation some data points, so you can download material and study this material on your own. If I'm able to run, let's see, the video, let's see, it should be somewhere. Okay. Well, in the interest of time, I'm trying to start maybe here. Okay, so this is the environment, this is a Scilab. Is running basically, this is the script on Scilab. I'm keeping a little bit ahead. Those are the data in real time that are acquired by the system. You see the familiar Scilab feature. So we are basically getting an FFT for the transformation of the current. All those currents are acquired in real time, plotted by the script, delivered. The FFT is actually calculated Scilab, and this is the environment that is connected and running in parallel. So the operator, myself in this case, I'm operating over here, so connecting and changing all the parameters and the script within Scilab is getting all those data and showing me the effective data and the current information of what I'm doing. So the operation that people could do in the field with this type of environment are greatly amplified and greatly supported by this wonderful Scilab environment that many of our, let's say, especially small customers are really starting to appreciate. In terms of performances, compared to an alternative, it's another company that's the bigger one, I would say, is not really that bad. There is if the other company is making 100, Scilab is running around 80, so not that bad for a product that's is a professional level. As you see, the video is going on and on. I'm making certain parameters, certain optimization, changing, for example, the current. The product is very robust. What we discovered that is also very extremely robust. To give you a little bit of the picture, always in the interest of time. So this is the actual motor that is connected for this experiment, and you see on the side, is and connected to the embedded environment. Let's see, over here, and this is the actual embedded environment. Some of you probably saw this this application in some of our trade shops. That ends my presentation, so thank you for having had the possibility to present these systems, and I'm hoping that the SciLab group is going ahead for many, many years. So, thank you.